it's a very broad nomenclature of BI. So KPI means which of the object. It may be a chart, it may be a table, it may be a graph, or maybe a filter, where the data is there, where it gives you some sense. That is called KPI. Based on which you can take some decisions.
Okay.
Don't make sense.
Amit, unable to follow, I just joined, so could you please repeat that? You're saying something.
Yeah, yes, Srinivas was asking that, you know, what's your K, what is the KPI normal definitions? Why?
Oh, okay.
It's called KPI, right? So I'm just repeating that.
Yeah.
So KPI is a technical name. I think you can also explain that. So, you know, irrespective of any object type, wherever the, it is a relationship of data, where the data representation is there and on which the user can take decision, that is what we call as a KPI.
Okay.
It may be a table, it may be a bar chart, it may be a pie chart, it may be a filter, okay. So it may be a calendar which represents, represents list of dates. So that is what we call as a KPI.
Okay.
Now we were creating a dashboard here. So this dashboard, which I just said, dashboard cannot be called as a KPI because it does not represent the data by itself. It is a frame which arrange multiple objects and show in a single window. Now I have this dashboard title, as I was just discussing that what nomenclature you should give on the dashboard. You should be giving the average measures. Those are used in multiple charts. That you can give the name of this dashboard. These are the four KPIs we are going to include in our dashboard, and four KPIs we have average measure is revenue, which is used in most of the charts.
And how you have created this name, revenue analysis?
Sorry, come again?
Now how you created this revenue analysis, the name of the dashboard?
So, I just created a revenue analysis so that, you know, how it would make more sense to user. I can create dashboard 1, dashboard 2, but that would not be more identical.
Okay.
So nomenclature is done something like this. Now,
Amit, if you can get me, get us the details of the naming standards of how to create the sheets and also how to create this dashboard naming standards, it would be really great and helpful for us.
Okay. In fact, you know, that is not readily initial document for me right now, but normally how it's followed. But anyway, I'll check, I'll just share.
Yeah, even in your organization, if you're using the naming standards, right? Not exact ones, but at least share us like a draft ones.
Okay, sure. That is not such a blueprint we received so far, but normally how we follows, that's a convention or a practice, raw practice, I just told you. So this convention we can also use. Now, when you give a KPI name, see your CV, you're preparing a CV. Your CV is your, first interview, you can say, your screening interview. Without, watching your face or interacting with you, looking with the CV, your interviewer will get most of the details about you. So likewise, without going to a KPI, if your name is self-explanatory, then it will make more sense to user, right? So that's why the KPI names are in such a way that customer-wise products, that means whoever will see, understand the customer-wise products count. So revenue is country-wise, it is sum of the revenue. So if you define this chart, the definition can be like this. Now this dashboard, which is a frame, which is not showing the data by itself, we give the normal name is an analysis. Revenue analysis, sales analysis, stock analysis, demography analysis, scorecard analysis, then summary report, something like that. So the standard will get it. But anyway, I'll check if any document I'll be getting beneficial. That's everything. Now, this is the dashboard name. I can also change the sheet name here. So this is the name which is taking a database field or automatic field, whichever the sheet name you create here, revenue analysis 1, 2, 3, whatever, it will automatically change the title. So I can make it a little bit So here these are the different type of objects we have. Now there are two different layouts in the dashboard. So as I said, I will not create any specific dimension, rather I will make it flexible here. So I will not changing the size up to desktop or in mobile or laptop, rather I will make it automatic. Here we have an option called fixed size and automatic size. So if you make it automatic, it will automatically span over the screen. So depending upon the resolution of the laptop, desktop, printer and all, it will automatically scale. So here there are two different layouts, one is tile, one is floating. So tile layout means the I'm giving a very simple example here. In your floor we are using tiles, right? So one tile cannot be placed on another tile. It should be always there would be always, you know, one tile side by side. So no one single tile cannot be placed or cannot be placed over another tile. So like this, an object, if you just drag one object, it take your entire space. Now if you drag another object, see, either bottom, either top, either left or right. So wherever you place it, it will take automatic size and it will fit. So these two charts cannot be placed one top of another. Now if you make it a floating layout, then floating means they will all float, or they will all don't have any specific size. So it can be placed on another chart. I just made the layout as floating. Now I will add another chart here. See, it can be placed on top of this. Okay. You got my point? What is the difference between floating and tile layout?
Yeah, got it.
No.
So I'll just remove it.
Yeah, could you explain what is floating?
So tile layout is one of my favorite because I don't want to drag, I don't want to shape the dashboard or KPI size by my own. Automatically, they will take their own shapes if you just drag them to your dashboard. Okay. So,
what is the floating?
Floating means one on top of one dashboard or one object, another object can be
placed.
Okay. But in tile, it would be just like, you know, tiling in a floor, like one tile cannot be placed on another tile.
Okay.
They will automatically scale themselves and fit in the dashboard in such a way so that they will have equal size.
Okay.
Like this, it is floating layout. I can drag a KPI. And it is not taking any size, right? It has its own size. Wherever I'll place, it will be placed here. See. Now in this case, this is also useful in some instances, but in most cases we are using tile. Float means they will not have any specific location to be placed. It can be placed on anywhere, any on top of any object. Okay. So I'm just closing it again. I will make it change the layout style and I drag this. Now here when I drag it, it will not be placed on any other object. Now see, can I place it on this bar chart? No, it is just taking its own shape, right? Wherever you try to fit it, automatically it will be fitted. So if I'm fitting it here, it's taking absolutely 50% of this column. I'm fitting it here, it is taking absolutely 50% of this column. Now if you fit here in this as this, it is taking absolutely 50%. So it's better to use a tile layout. Now if you fit it here, automatically it's taken the same. Fourth object, I will drag it accordingly and place it here. So see, I have never defined the size of this specific chart, so automatically they are fitted on my dashboard. Absolutely four equal sizes, right? So this is good for the designing for dashboard. I enclose it here. Now here you see, there are four dashboards, four KPIs I have. This one is these four are individual KPIs. So now I can just make their borders. Select one, just go to format, border, give the border as no border is applied on this chart. Like this here, select. This one also, I will make give some borders. So here, no one chart is superimposing on other chart, and they are taking absolutely equal shapes, and also their filters. Respective filters are also taking their own shapes, and they are aligned to the right side. Now, what next I have to do to close this dashboard? Just a second, give me a second. Yeah, so what next we have to do here, as you can see, once I'm just going for presentation view mode, the chart is scaled up with the size. Now you can see there are a lot of data here in this bottom chart, country and product wise revenue. Now, is it able to be audible? No, it is very squeezed and it's not easily understandable. So what we can make it, because the shape is very less, space is very less, and the data is so huge, and they have completely accommodated all set of data inside this shape. But though it fully compressed here, it is not audible, I mean it is not clearly visible. So I can just give this view here. There is this down arrow. Go for fit height, not fit by width, because in this chart the data is repeating by width. So don't fit by width here, you can fit by height, and rest of the data will be shown in a scroll bar. There will be a scroll bar here. See, now is it clearly visible? Hello?
Yes.
Earlier it was not visible. Why? Because it was fit with entire view. You see, this is not understandable because it's not readable, it's so squeezed. So I can just fit by, not make it width, because it would be the same, the entire data will be squeezed inside it. Make it fit by height. So this looks good now. Like this also, fit by height. Get the scroll bar. So which of the data you find like it is compressed, you can fit by height like this. So I got four scroll bars. It is now perfectly readable.
Only we can add only four objects, or how many? Like, what is the maximum number of objects we
I
can
can
add?
also add multiple. Say I would have two bar charts, I mean two pie charts. So in this four objects we can add four pie charts also. One, two, three, four. So it's not fixed that you can add four, but based on the readability factor, if it is so squeezed, you cannot read it, right? So you have to adjust like this. You can use two charts. If those star chart objects would be too huge and there are too much data, you can use it. Three, whichever the number you can use, it's up to you. Okay. So I just completely created one dashboard now. When I go for presentation view, I'll be having a single screen as well as individual objects. At this single screen where I can see the entire objects, seamless type of objects, and same type of objects here we have, all are the bar charts but different type of features are here. Restarted. Now, as you can see here, I have used this object, but still we have individual objects here. It is also visible. So now I no more require this object to be shown separately once I have used in a dashboard. So what we can do, right click, hide sheet. Our purpose is to decrease number of sheets and number of APIs would be here in the single screen. So I don't want much more tabs to be here in the bottom, so that it would create a clumsy situation. Hide sheets. So whichever the sheets would be used by a dashboard only, those sheets will have the hide sheet option. Say for example, I'll just remove this KPI from this chart, from this dashboard, and it will be open. Then you would not have the hide sheet option here. Though I have used it in a dashboard, it is now consumed, so it would have an option of hide sheet. Yeah. So first dashboard with the bar chart is complete. Now let me start with the block chart. Or trim off here. We'll go for a shift. So this is applicable to one dashboard and one measure, or one or more measures. Even one or more dimension you can also use here in this trim off. Now, here the data is represented in boxes. The bigger the box will have the bigger volume of data, and smaller is the reverse. Now I may think of to add anything like city. Okay, I will add a city wise discount applied. Say, though data has a longitudinal latitude, it also mapped with the map, but I'm not going to create a map chart now, so that's why I'll remove the longitudinal latitude. So we just remove it. I can use a state. I can use this city. So I have list of cities, and based on the different cities, let's see based on the product and how many discounts are applied on those cities.
Thank you.
data is not proper. So let me remove this measure and say city wise stocks available with me in the system. Now I can simply choose this block chart. Here you are getting the differences. So though these boxes are not relatively small or big, but the data is different here. The data variation is not so far. So that's why it is the boxes are apparently looking like they are equal, but they are not equal actually. So if you have a very long gap of the data, then the boxes will be bigger and smaller and it will be more easily identified. But anyway, if these numbers are showing in a series, but still, how do you easily identify which one is bigger in this number? So the more you have the data, the more you have the darker color density, the less you have the data volume, the less you have the color density. So it is easy in case of a table box. If you just simply represent this, is it, you know, how do you get the maximum and minimum easily? It's difficult, right? Because this data are not so variant, so it is apparently more nearer to each other. So if you go for a tree map, it will be more useful to understand this data, whichever is bigger and smaller. This is city by this stock available in the market. Now you can also add the quantity to label to show the quantity on top of this cells also. Just add the quantity to label. It is also showing the labels here. Now you can change the data or the color here. This is a gradient effect. One color is only applied, that is blue, and rest of all data are mixed up with the densities or the Faraday effect to represent it. So I change the color, edit color, and you can change the color type, anything. Maybe this one.
How can we have multicolor ones in that? Like one tile is having different color and the other tile is having different color.
Okay. So in that case, we can use this thing. Quantity, I'm based on this quantity, I'm showing continuous. Okay. If I just make it discrete, it would be different colors. So in this case, it is not so identical or better for decision making. Now tell me, without looking at this number, which one is a bigger? Difficult, right?
Yeah.
To analyze, because their data are equal, but there seems to be the box are seems to be equal, because between 3086 and 3252, there is not so far difference. So the boxes are little bit different, but they're not so much different so to easily identify. So this color is good looking, but for better decision making, the threshold coloring is more useful. That coloring is also called threshold coloring, wherever we will have one color and there will be a list of densities.
And what is this discrete and continuous?
Discrete and continuous, I'll tell you. So every items will have a discrete color. Discrete means different. Okay, different colors. Continuous means based on a single color which will apply, it will continuously flowing with the same color range by mixing up with, you know, by adding the color density. So I can have different color palettes here. I can change this color theme. I have winters, I have summer, this green, yellow, orange, this light,
How to make it as discrete continuous?
Yeah, I'll do. You can select a hue color. So color palettes are applying. Once you're selecting color palette, then assign palette. Assign palette. The palette is assigned here. This color, then apply. Now you are getting this color. Now this effect now looking, though it is looking good, but it is not good for decision making, right?
Yes.
Good. It is difficult to say which one is bigger and smaller in a fraction of a second. So here there is a down arrow based on this quantity. You know, this is my measure now. This is my measure which is added to the color, right? Measure is quantity, sum of quantity which is added to the color panel. So that's why we are getting different colors. Now, just go to this down arrow. There is an option called discrete, which will show color by discrete. Okay, every color should have a discrete identity. Now, if you select continuous, it would be having a single color, but it's more identical and more easier to make a decision. There is a range also here. The more data you have, it will be red. The less data you have, it will be blue. So this is not a discrete actually. This is a continuous color. Because there's a, in the range, you have higher is this one, lower is this one. Right. Just go to this effect, say this one here. It is more, whichever the person is seeing this chart, they can easily say this is the higher color, higher data, because it is more highlighted and more darker. Now I will go for a data like this, say this is one. I will have another thing, say product or customer wise sales. It's still here also, there is not so much bigger differences I'm getting, because this database has not so much variations. I will also have another database tomorrow, so that to get much more discrete data. So this is showing product wise sales, this is showing city wise stocks. Here I can just change the color if it has a discrete. Change the color to represent on this one. Same palette, apply, okay. Sales I have added, so I'll just add sales to label. This way, customer wise. Now I can make it even more better by adding different years. So it will be two-dimensional. It will be kind of two-dimensional chart. So I'll just add years here. Okay. Years. I'll just even give you more clarity on that tomorrow, because I've got time to rush for the office. So let's conclude the session today. We'll meet tomorrow at the same time, and in the meanwhile, PJ, you can have my number also. And both of you can give me a text message. So if at all I'm changing the meeting tomorrow, I'll just share with the new meeting. Share the meeting. Okay, guys, so meet you tomorrow at the same time. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.